cylinder in R1 plus 2. So you have t and x coordinates, and you take a cylinder, the absolute value of x squared is equal to 1. So that's your support function. And you take S to be the set where h is less than 0. Then clearly, the pseudo-convexity condition is violated. Right? Actually, it has exactly the opposite sign. And there exist, in that case, there exist V, which are smooth, so smooth functions V, and solutions phi of this equation such that unique continuation fails, okay? Which contradict unique continuation. So this is a very important example. Unfortunately, you cannot say in advance, you cannot give a V and say in advance that you'll find a counterexample. You really, the counterexample tells you that there exists a phi and a V together.
Okay? Are they real?
And they are real. Right, so this will make sense for any pseudo-Riemannian metric, any non-degenerate metric.
And it's empty for Riemannian?
And it's empty. So in the Riemannian case, it's always satisfied. Good point. Right? So in the Riemannian case, of course, you have a Laplace equation, and obviously unique continuation always holds for that. Right? Okay. So let's go to preamble number 2, which has to do with extension of Killing vector fields. So let's take a pseudo-Riemannian metric. Space, I'm sorry, MG, so the metric is pseudo-Riemannian, an open subset O included in M, so now the big set is an entire manifold, and the smooth Killing vector field Z in O. Right? So you have a symmetry in O, and you want to know whether you can extend it to the whole manifold. So again, the question is, under what assumptions does Z extend uniquely as a Killing vector field in M? Okay? So there is a very simple theorem due to Nomizu that says that, again, if G is real analytic and O, M and O are connected, and M is simply connected, so it's a very simple topological condition, then extension holds true. Okay? So again, the emphasis is on real analyticity. Real analyticity essentially kills the problems. It makes it extremely easy.
So
Killing vector field is a vector field which generates an isometry group. So in particular, if the metric, then you have a V set to be a Killing vector field if the lead derivative is equal to 0, of the metric is equal to 0. Okay. All right. So so that's the situation. Now. So remark, the metric is not assumed to satisfy any specific equation, right? Just analyticity is enough. I mean, you could say that there is an equation lurking in the background, which is a Cauchy-Riemann equation, you could say. No assumptions are needed about the boundary of O in M, and the result is global with only minimal assumptions on the topology, right? So this is sort of a very nice situation. Of course, nothing of this stays true if you replace analyticity by smoothness. In fact, you can very easily find plenty of counterexamples, right? Okay, so these were the first two preambles. Now let me go to the main rigidity conjecture. Okay, so again, as I said, I'm talking about Einstein equations, and in particular Einstein equations in vacuum. So what are those? So talk about metrics G, which are Lorentzian. This makes sense also for pseudo-Riemannian, if you want, but the interesting case is Lorentzian. You have a metric, and you have the Ricci curvature of the metric is identically equal to 0. This is simply the Einstein vacuum equations. And there is a famous family of solutions of these Einstein vacuum equations, which are called the Kerr spacetimes. So here is the family. The four-dimensional family, depending on two parameters, A and M. There is a range of parameters, which maybe I'll say a few words later on. And as you see, it's an explicit solution. It's not very.
So did you say it was four-dimensional?
Four-dimensional, right. So you see you have the variables are t, phi, r, and theta.
Oh, but it's a two-parameter family.
It's a two-parameter family of metrics in 3 plus 1 dimensions, right, mm-hmm. In R4. And they are what are called the Kerr family of solutions, discovered by Kerr in 63. The original family was discovered when A equal to 0, was discovered by Schwarzschild, and that's a famous Schwarzschild metric. So A equal to zero corresponds exactly to the Schwarzschild metric. And this simple-looking solutions of the Einstein vacuum equations are really at the basis of black hole theory. So whatever we know about black holes is really based on these solutions. Okay, and of course, the amazing thing about these simple solutions of a very appealing mathematical equation are, in fact, correspond to real physical phenomena, right? So the whole, again, I mean, we believe now that there are black holes all over in the universe, in particular in the center of galaxies. So now, of course, they pose a lot of mathematical problems, about which I will discuss in a second. So let me just mention that this family is algebraically special in the sense that 18 of the 20 components of the curvature tensor vanish in a suitable frame. So there exists a certain frame, which you have to find also, relative to which 18 of the curvature components are equal to zero. The other two are not. Right? So this is called the type D. OK, so let's look at the key.
Go back to that for a second.
Sure.
So where do I see the black hole here?
OK, I'll come to it in a second.
OK, okay, so.
This is just a formal thing. And in fact, it took people about 50 years to understand what a black hole is. So they had a solution. They had the Schwarzschild solution in 1916, right? It was written down. It took about 60 years.
No.
No. It took about 16 years to recognize what are the properties of that. OK, but let me summarize. Obviously, I won't be able to talk in details, but let me summarize at least some of the basic properties of this solution. First of all, of course, the solution of the Einstein equations is not that easy to check. I mean, it will take you probably a day or so, okay, just to check it, right? Just to plug in a formula. But anyway, it is a solution of the Einstein vacuum equation. It has a Killing vector field, dt, which is time-like at infinity. So let me explain this. You recognize that the coefficients here, so the fact that d over dt in these coordinates is a Killing vector field, simply says that the coefficients are time-independent, nothing more, okay? So I mean, you can just check that they are indeed time independent. D over dt is certainly Killing. I'm sorry?
Is it spherically symmetric?
No. This is not spherically symmetric. The Schwarzschild solution will be spherically symmetric when A equal to 0. Otherwise, it's not. It's axially symmetric. You can also recognize that there is an axis of symmetry. We'll see it in a second. So when I say time-like at infinity, I'll come back to this in a second. I mean, maybe I'll do something right now. You recognize that actually, if you look at this parameter r, and you take r to go to infinity, you easily see that all coefficients go to 1 and zeros and 1s, right? And you get in the limit, you get, in fact, the Minkowski spacetime. So this is typically to asymptotic flatness. It's an asymptotically flat solution of the Einstein vacuum equations. And of course, as you go to infinity, d over dt is a standard d over dt of Minkowski space, right? Okay, so it's a Killing vector field, and it's, of course, time-like. It has a direction of time. Okay, so asymptotic flatness I just explained. It's a smooth metric with bifurcate sphere. I'll describe maybe a little bit later. And it has global hyperbolicity. Global hyperbolicity is a little bit like completeness in Riemannian geometry. It simply means that I cannot take artificially points away from the manifold, right? So all the points that should be there are there. Okay. So that I'm not going to say more than that. OK, there is also this non-degeneracy condition, which corresponds, in fact, to A strictly less than M. And it will play an important role. And I'll say a few more words about it later on. That's called the extremal Kerr solution. For A strictly larger than M, you get a family of solutions which are very bad physically. You get all sorts of physical violations. Okay? So cosmic censorship will be completely violated.
What does degeneracy mean? So the metric is not good?
No. It just means that it's at the boundary of the acceptable regime. Okay? I'll say more about in a second. You'll see. I mean, it's connected, in fact, to this bifurcate sphere property. But I'll come to it in a second. OK, then there are two more properties. First one, there is a second Killing vector field, which is just d over d phi, which has closed orbits. This corresponds to axial symmetry. Again, you just read it from the form of the metric that the coefficients are phi independent, right? So therefore, it's also axially symmetric.
So it means actually symmetric.
Axially symmetric. Right, so this is axial symmetry. And of course, it's really analytic because any explicit solution has to be real analytic by definition. So of course it's real analytic, right? Okay, so here is a definition. A vacuum space-time verifying this condition is called a regular non-degenerate stationary vacuum. So let me say a few more words about this. So you can define for arbitrary solution of the Einstein vacuum equations, you can define a notion of stationarity. Stationarity means there exists a kinetic vector field which is time-like at infinity. Okay. At infinity, it makes sense, of course, because of asymptotic flatness. So again, asymptotic flatness is a general property that you can define.
That means it looks
like a Minkowski space very far away. Okay? So that's something very general. So stationary is very clear. Regular means that global hyperbolicity and smoothness are satisfied. And non-degeneracy is what I promised to tell you in a second. So actually, maybe I'll do it right now. Maybe it's better to go to the next picture. So here is a picture of the Kerr solution. In fact, it's called the external part of the Kerr solution. And it's a picture in corresponding to a conformal compactification of the metric. Right? So this is a typical Penrose diagram. The infinity, so these boundaries here are in fact boundaries at infinity. Okay, they are called the scribe plus and scribe minus, and they correspond to endpoint of null geodesics. In fact, any null geodesic is represented in this picture at 45 degrees. Okay, so these are all the endpoints of null geodesics. This point, which is called I0, is space-like infinity, and they correspond to endpoints of space-like curves or geodesics. And this one here is a point of future infinity. And it corresponds to endpoints of time-like geodesics. In fact, it's not a point, of course. I mean, one should be very careful because this picture can be misleading. It's really not a point. It's a whole set, three-dimensional set, let's say. And this is also a three-dimensional manifold. OK, so.
I'm not sure what this picture actually means. Is this a space? What is the space here that you're showing on the slide here?
So this is. So this is the part of the Kerr solution which corresponds to R larger than something. It's R larger than.
So this is supposed to represent the.
It's supposed to represent the exterior of the black hole. Okay. So this boundary. So let me talk about this boundary and then. All right? So this boundary is actually the boundary of the black hole. So there is a null hypersurface here which is also represented at 45 degrees, which is completely smooth. There is absolutely no problem with it. Okay. In fact, the entire manifold here is smooth. And beyond this, you enter into the so-called black hole. So black hole being characterized by the fact that time-like geodesics will never reach this scribe plus. Okay? And in fact, you expect that they will reach a singularity. Okay? So once you are in black hole, there are certain results due to Penrose and others that tell you that, in fact, you cannot have a complete picture of the black hole. So the black hole has to end up in some form of singularity. I'm not representing the picture of the interior of the black hole. In fact, the interior of the black hole is supposed to be very unstable. It's only this side which is supposed to be stable. Now, let me say that this picture. So this picture is, of course, one more thing. You see that the capital T vector field, which is d over dt, you see that it's time-like here, right? It's time-like, meaning exactly that it points in the interior of the light constant point. But as you approach the black hole, T changes and becomes space-like. This is typical to the Kerr solution. In the case of the Schwarzschild solution, T still degenerates, but doesn't become space-like. It becomes null. Okay, so it becomes tangent to the null hypersurface. Okay, so that's roughly the picture. Now, this picture can actually be realized also for a general stationary solution, which I mentioned earlier. In fact, the way you do it, you using asymptotic flatness, you define these points at infinity. And then you look at the past or future null infinity. And the complement of the past or future null infinity and the future of the past null infinity, which is this one, is exactly what you define to be the black hole region. Okay? So you can define the black hole region in full generality. And then the boundaries, you can show that there have to be some boundaries, and the boundaries are called the horizon, the event horizons of the black hole. Right? Now, non-degeneracy means, okay, so now you have a geometric representation of non-degeneracy. It just means that these two null hypersurfaces intersect transversally. And this point, of course, it's actually a two-sphere. Right? Is that clear?
We're supposed to think of this. This is we have to rotate this picture somehow, right?
Of course, yeah. I mean, it's obviously impossible to do.
You're in the actual coordinates.
Yeah, right. True. Yeah, so you have to think of some kind of rotation. Okay, so that's basically the Kerr solution. Obviously, it takes some time to get used to it, but after a while, you see that it's not that difficult at all, and it's a very compelling picture. Okay, so now here is the main rigidity conjecture. So any regular non-degenerate stationary vacuum solution, right? So again, this is a solution of the Einstein equations, which verify the properties that we mentioned earlier. I'm sorry? Yeah, exactly, the first three. Is such that its domain of outer communication, domain of outer communication is exactly this. It's exactly what I represent in this picture. So everything up to the horizon, up to the event horizon, right? So the domain of outer communication of such a stationary spacetime is isometric with the domain of outer communication, the same picture, of the actual Kerr solution for an A between 0 and M, okay?
I don't understand the
statement. Okay, so you can define this picture in general, right? So for any stationary solution, any stationary, it doesn't have to be axially symmetric in particular. No, absolutely. So for any stationary solution, and you say that, in fact, under the assumptions which I made, it has to be, in fact, isometric. So this picture is completely isometric with a picture of the Kerr solution, right? So the metric is, in fact, the Kerr metric. Okay, so it's a very strong rigidity result. In principle, there could be plenty of stationary solutions. Turns out that they are all parameterized by these two parameters. Right?
What's the motivation for this conjecture?
Oh, okay. I mean, this is obviously huge because think of the general evolution problem, right? So, okay, that's a good question. I don't like problems without motivation either. Imagine the initial value problem in general relativity, right? So obviously, the initial value problem is the most important problem in general relativity, right? I mean, everybody here will agree. So you want to study the evolution of initial data sets, okay? And under the condition of asymptotic flatness. So the so-called final state conjecture, which is sort of the biggest conjecture of all, even going beyond cosmic censorship, for example, will tell you that if I start up with any initial data here, then the evolution of it will be very complicated. You will form black holes and maybe colliding black holes, and all sorts of things can happen. But eventually, you are going to see, asymptotically, you are going to see just the finite number of black holes moving away from each other. And those black holes will be exactly the Kerr solutions. Okay? So what is the motivation behind this conjecture? Well, it's exactly the fact that of course, in general relativity, being a relativistic equation, you generate gravitational waves. And the gravitational waves move away from any finite region, right? As they move away, asymptotically, you expect that things will become stationary. And therefore, stationarity will imply, according to this conjecture, like that you have the Kerr solution. I'm sorry? Like solitons. Kerr are solitons, of course. Exactly. Right? It's without question. They're much more complicated than the usual solitons, but they are still solitons. Okay, so all right. So this is a conjecture. So let me tell you what is known about it. So first of all, in 1971, Carter made a very important observation that if you assume also axial symmetry, right? So stationary plus axial symmetry. So you make two assumptions, and of course all the other asymptotic flatness and regular and so on and so forth. Then he could show infinitesimally that there could be only 2 degrees of freedom. Okay. So this was made into a real theorem by Robinson in 1975, which actually proved that for axially symmetric black holes, the conjecture holds true, right? So if you have axial symmetry stationary black holes, they are exactly the Kerr, right? So that was a very beautiful result involving a lot of methods actually of Riemannian geometry, PD and Riemannian geometry. So then Hawking made the observation that the conjecture holds true in the case of real analytic spacetimes. So if you also assume
without axis symmetry.
So he could show that, in fact, what he showed is that if you have a real analytic spacetime, then you have automatically you have axial symmetry. That's his observation, and I'll discuss it right now. So Hawking made this observation based on what the so-called Hawking rigidity theorem, which, as I just mentioned, reduces the general case to the axial symmetric one. Okay. So in other words, if you have a spacetime which is stationary and real analytic, then it's axially symmetric. Therefore, it must be Kerr. Okay.
But the idea is, if I don't have something which is actually symmetric, then it can't be stationary. It has to evolve, and then eventually, if I wait for long enough, it will look like one of these axially symmetric guys.
You could try to come up with all sorts of.
Is that more or less correct? Or
you could, sure.
Through radiation effects.
Sure. No. Yeah, that's another important. That's another issue, which has to do with the possibility of having two black holes. So the conjecture there will be only one black hole. Okay.
Because then if they have two black holes. They
but even that is not understood. Even that is not understood.
If you have two black holes, yeah. They wouldn't be stationary.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. But even that thing is not understood. Okay. But let me talk about the Hawking rigidity now. So the observation, in fact. Made by him is that if you have a horizon of a real analytic stationary solution, then it's a killing horizon. So let me explain what that is. So actually, this observation was like this. You look at the horizon. So imagine that this is a space-like hypersurface, which it corresponds to the horizon in the picture we had before, right? So we had this picture here, which was this would be the points at infinity. So this is a horizon. And you start up with a stationary solution. So you have a vector field here, which is T. And it's not too difficult to show that the stationary vector field, T, will have to become tangent to the horizon. So if you imagine the horizon is actually a three-dimensional hypersurface, so it will have to move like this on the horizon. Okay. And but because it's also killing, it's very easy to see that the points, if you look at any null generator, in other words, along any null geodesic, and you start up with a point and you follow the integral curves of the vector field, you'll get the next time when you hit the null hypersurface, the generator, in fact, this will generate a new isometry. So it's a very simple observation that you could generate a new isometry, but of course, it would be an isometry only along the null hypersurface, okay? Right? So it's very easy to produce an infinitesimal killing vector field along the null hypersurface. It's almost a triviality. In fact, if the metric is non-degenerate, it's a triviality, okay? And then if you have real analyticity, you can apply Nomizu's theorem and conclude that the vector field extends everywhere. So now I have two killing vector fields. It's easy to show that they have to commute. And then you can easily produce an axially symmetric killing vector field from it. Okay, so that's basically his proof. So it's just an observation. It's nothing more than an observation that if you have real analyticity, the problem becomes trivial. Okay. All right. So this here is the main ideas again. The tangency of T to the horizon implies that there exists an infinitesimal killing vector field normal to the horizon. Normal means that it's in the direction of null generators. Then you extend the Hawking vector field using a simple variant of Nomizu's theorem. You check that it commutes with T, and then define the axially symmetric killing vector field Z as a linear combination of T and K, and you have done. Right? Then you are in the axially symmetric case for which the theorem holds true. By the way, the theorem of Carter and Robinson holds true for smooth solutions. Right? It doesn't require analyticity. Again, without analyticity, it would be, yeah. Well, I mean, if you are in the theorem of Carter-Robinson, you need that these two vector fields commute. But you know, this is almost a triviality. I mean, it should always be true. Okay, so you have to have you have to have that you have two Kini vector fields which commute. So you have the axially symmetric Kini vector field and the stationary commute. Right? Okay. So with this so the question now is analyticity reasonable? So common sense dictates that analyticity should be actually proved, not assumed. Okay. So by assuming, he has completely killed the problem, in fact. Right? Because there is no, as we know, as I made the remarks earlier, in the Nomisius theorem, you don't need the Einstein equations anymore if you apply the Nomisius theorem. You just apply analyticity, which has nothing to do with the Einstein equations, has nothing to do with the relativistic properties of the Einstein equations, which are based on domains of dependence. Analyticity makes no sense. Domain of dependence arguments make no sense in the analytic category. So the assumption of analyticity is really a cheat. Okay, I mean it completely trivializes the problem, and there is no excuse for it. In particular, if you think about the finite state conjecture, there is no reason why the solution in evolution should become somehow analytic. I mean there is absolutely no, right? So obviously analyticity should be proved, not assumed. So as part of the conjecture, you have to prove. So Ionescu and I have started in 2008 to look at this problem and try to get rid of analyticity. And of course, if you get rid of analyticity, the whole picture looks very, very different. So I'll try to give in the rest of the talk, I'll try to give some ideas. So first of all, conjecture, the first result we proved is that the conjecture holds true in full generality, but provided that a certain scalar identity is assumed to be satisfied on the bifurcate sphere. So here, unlike Hawking, the non-degeneracy condition plays a crucial role, and you should see later on that there are counterexamples. If you don't have, if you have degeneracy, there will be counterexamples. So what I'm saying that if you look at the picture of this bifurcate horizon, so you have the future horizon and the past horizon. So here is a bifurcation. So the claim is that if on this bifurcate sphere I have a certain identity satisfied, and of course this identity will be satisfied in the Kerr solution, then I have proved the result. Okay, and of course, I mean, I hope you will agree that such a condition will be certainly much less than analyticity, a lot less than real analyticity, but still it's not satisfactory. This is an algebraic condition. Okay. I'll talk maybe if I have time. I'll talk about it. I don't know how much time I'll have. I will talk about it. It's a very interesting condition. But unfortunately, you cannot check it. You cannot verify. If I give you a stationary spacetime, I mean, okay, it's a simple condition, but there's no reason why it should be verified. Okay. So the next result that we proved was this time with Alexakis, is to show that the conjecture holds true provided that the spacetime is assumed to be sufficiently close in a geometric sense to a Kerr spacetime. In other words, I have a stationary solution, smooth, no other assumptions. It's not axially symmetric. But I assume that it's sufficiently close to the Kerr spacetime, then it has to be the Kerr spacetime. Okay? So it's a local rigidity result, which is completely consistent with the other big conjecture in this field, which is the stability of the Kerr spacetime. So another big problem, problem where there is a lot of effort being done right now is to prove the stability of the Kerr spacetimes. But obviously, I won't get into this now. Okay, so what our result was based on, so this is the result with Alexakis, is that, and this was a purely local result that we proved, which was that without any additional assumptions, in other words, all I assume is that I have a stationary solution of the Einstein equation, which is smooth, and it has this bifurcate horizon. Right? Then, and of course, it obviously it's stationary. Then we show that in a neighborhood of the bifurcate sphere, it has to be axially symmetric. Okay? Right? So that, and once you show this local result, then the idea would be to extend it. And in fact, in the result which I mentioned earlier, that's exactly what we do. So in this result, we start up with this observation, which is not based on the fact that the space-time is close to Kerr. It's a general result. But then later on, in order to extend, we need closeness to Kerr. So that's So what are the main ideas of our result? So first of all, it's very easy. OK, so let me go back here and draw a nicer picture. So this is a bifurcate sphere. This is a horizon. OK. So if I extend the horizon inside the black hole, and this one inside, actually, this would be the white hole. Anyway, but we are not interested on this side. We're interested only on this side. So I extend this horizon to the future. Then I get here two null hypersurfaces. Okay? And it's very easy to see using Hawking argument. But in this particular, in the degenerate case, Hawking's argument is interesting, I would say. I mean, it's not deep, but it's interesting. In the non-degenerate case, which is the one that we are dealing with, this is totally trivial to show that there exists a second Killing vector field. So you have a T, right, which rotates along the horizon. It's very easy to show that there exists another one, which I'll call K. So you have T and K, right? And so you have K defined here and here. Then it's also very easy to see that K, if K can be extended inside, it has to satisfy a wave equation. So the ambition of K is equal to zero. So the idea is then to solve the Cauchy problem, which is a characteristic Cauchy problem, with data, so it's like a Goursat problem, with data on two characteristics, and solve this wave equation inside, and you get a solution. And that indeed is sort of the right way to do it. Okay, so that's what they did. So it's just a simple observation. However, you can say, well, why don't I do exactly the same thing here? I have K defined here and here. Why don't I extend it exactly in the same way? I solve the ambition of K equal to zero. Well, OK, this is an nilpotent problem. Okay, so this is an nilpotent problem even in Minkowski space. So let me recall that if you have the wave equation, if you have a light cone like this, and I solve the equation, the Lambertian of phi is equal to 0 in the exterior with data here. So I have phi is f. So I give characteristic data. And I have two solutions. Well, so anyway, so this problem is ill-posed. Okay? It's an ill-posed problem. However, you still hope to prove uniqueness. But uniqueness, unique continuation. But unique continuation has nothing to do with what you really need here, which is an extension. So you really need to extend. So you have to do something entirely different. So what we do, in fact, let's see, what did I do with my. Oh, yeah, OK. So what you do instead is extend K to a full neighborhood of S by solving a transport equation. So the idea is to look at null geodesics going this way. So let's call L the generator of those geodesics. And then you lead transport K along L. So you take this to be 0. OK, in fact, actually, you take it to be proportional to L, right? Something like this. You don't need to be exactly 0, but proportional to L. So this is just an ordinary differential equation. In other words, I'm extending using null geodesics in my spacetime. I'm extending K, which is defined here on the horizon. I'm extending it by a transport equation. Of course, if I do that, there's no reason why what I get should be a Killing vector field, right? OK? So to show that K is a Killing vector field, we do it by unique continuation argument. So that's where unique continuation comes in. So the idea is roughly that you look at the integral curves, you look at the flow generated by K. So you extend K, as I said. You look at the flow, and you create new metrics, phi t star of g. Okay, so and if K was to be a Killing vector field, then this has to be an isometry. So phi t star of g should be exactly equal to g. Okay, and that's where we use uniqueness at this level. We show indeed that these two metrics are the same. Okay? And that involves a complicated system of partial differential equations, and you have to check the pseudo convexity condition and so on and so forth. But I'll give you a different proof today, so maybe I'm not going to go into the details now. OK, so I roughly explained to you the first four parts, and now let me go into the new results. Okay, so these are results of this year. So theorem number one, it's a generalization of this result, which I mentioned here. So it's a generalization in the following sense. Imagine that I have an arbitrary manifold, which is pseudo-Riemannian, and the subset O and the killing vector field Z on O, right? So such that Z is killing vector field, and the boundary of O, right, on the manifold is strongly pseudo-convex at some point P, let's say. Okay, so it's a local result. So that's all. That's the only assumption. And of course, it has to be Ricci flat, so the Einstein equations are satisfied, right? That's very important. So without that equation, nothing can be proved. Then the result is that Z extends as a unique killing vector field to a neighborhood of P. Okay, so that's the first result. And I recall that strong pseudo-convexity in Riemannian or in pseudo-Riemannian geometry means, again, the fact that you have this Hessian condition satisfied for every vector field tangent to the boundary, which is null. Okay? So that's sort of what we had before. So again, if this condition is satisfied, then you are fine. So what happens? The question is, what happens if the condition is not satisfied? Okay. So here is another result. We show that. So here, this is, I think it's a very sort of unexpected result in many ways. You look at the picture of the Kerr solution. So imagine now that I'm looking exactly at the Kerr solution depending on A&M, so fixed Kerr solution. On this side, up to the event horizon, it's non-degenerate also. Non-degenerate simply means that A is less than M. Okay, so it has this transversality condition satisfied. Okay, so we know the killing vector fields extend here in the neighborhood of this. Okay, because the reason is that pseudo-convexity condition is actually satisfied here at such points because of the transversality. Okay? So the issue is what happens at the point away from the bifurcation sphere. Well, here it's very easy to see that actually the strict pseudo-convexity condition is not satisfied. In fact, it degenerates. And we prove, in fact, that there exists an extension of the Kerr metric on this side to a stationary solution of the Einstein vacuum equation on this side, which is not axially symmetric. So we proved that locally, you can always make extensions which are not axially symmetric. So it shows that, you know, the whole philosophy of Hawking is wrong. There is no way you can do anything locally. I mean, in order to solve the problem, you need global information. Okay? Right? So again, pseudo-convexity is satisfied here. Therefore, you can prove local rigidity. It's not satisfied at points on the bifurcated sphere, and therefore we show counterexamples that show that you can have, in fact, stationary solutions which are not axially symmetric.
Those counterexamples rely on non-analyticity.
Of course, of course. Real analytic, obviously.
Okay.
Of course, exactly. Okay, so that's a second result. So let me go a little bit into. All right, so the moral is that there is no hope to construct an additional symmetry, as in Hawking's rigidity theorem, but rely only on local information, as I just said. Okay, so so let me go back and prove theorem one for you. I mean, well, I won't prove. I'll show the main ideas. To get a global result, you need global structure, right? So absolutely, absolutely. So for example, in our uniqueness of Kerr, we need a lot of global information about. Right, so we have this local rigidity of the Kerr, local global, the local global, right? Rigidity of the Kerr spacetime. It's based on a lot of global information, in particular global information about the Kerr solution, because which you want to preserve in the perturbation. Okay, so. So let's go back to the proof of the first theorem. So remember, the first theorem was. Let me go back. Is that you can extend, if I give you an O and a killing vector field, I can extend the killing vector field provided that I have strong pseudo convexity. So here's how it goes. OK, so let me make a picture again. All right, so we have O here, let's say. So this is a point P. And I want to extend in a neighborhood. The pseudo-convexity is satisfied at this point. Okay? I look in the first approximation. I look at null geodesics, which are transversal to the boundary. Okay? Obviously, I'll find lots of them, provided, of course, that the boundary is non-characteristic. I should have mentioned the boundary obviously has to be non-characteristic. Okay, so because of this, obviously, I found transversal geodesics. So let's take a geodesic vector field, so such that DLL is equal to zero, in a neighborhood of P. Okay, now we extend Z. So this is sort of a very interesting way of extending things, which we haven't seen anywhere else. You extend it by using a second order operator, the second order differential transport equation, where on the left you have the second covariant derivative with respect to L of the vector field Z, and on the right you have this curvature applied to L, Z, and L. So
this is a Jacobi.
So this is exactly the Jacobi, right? Then we define the deformation tensor of Z. This is just the Lie derivative. So Z is a vector field which we want to extend. So you take the deformation tensor. Obviously, to show that this is killing, you have to show that pi is zero. Okay. Right. So we cannot show that pi is zero by itself. We need to invoke also the curvature, something at the level of the curvature. So what you do is you define so-called Weyl tensor, which is the Lie derivative of the Riemann curvature tensor with respect to Z. And you subtract something from it, which in particular makes W to be a traceless Weyl tensor. So this will have all the symmetries of the Riemann curvature tensor. And the trace of it will be zero. Of course, the trace of R is zero, but it's not clear that the trace of this is zero. Okay, so that's why you have to make this deformation. Actually, this deformation is quite interesting in its own right, but it's based, in fact, on pi, right? So this is the pi that we have here. And what's interesting is that you also need an anti-symmetric two-form, which has to be appropriately defined. Okay, so with this kind of construction, you define this tensor, which is essentially a rotational, somehow relative to the first two components, alpha and beta, of pi, minus is d mu of w. So this, unfortunately, I don't think I'll have time to justify why this comes up. Maybe I'll say a few words, however. Yeah, so, and then you get a complicated system of wave equations combined with transport equations, which have the following form. So let me try first to describe this W. So W, in fact, so remember that W is like Lie Z of R minus some kind of correction. And it's very easy to see that it satisfies a divergence equation. So divergence of W is something which involves pi times derivative of R, and then plus d pi times R, derivatives of pi times R. Now, fortunately, this derivative of pi are exactly of this form. Okay, so that's one of the sort of miracles of the computations, that these are exactly the derivatives that you need, which come up in this calculation. Okay. Now, in other words, you express this in terms of p times r, and then it's easy to see that you get a wave equation from this by simply observing also that this satisfy the Bianchi identity. So w alpha beta gamma delta. Let's put an epsilon here. If you take anti-symmetric permutation of these indices, you get something which looks very similar to this. Again, pi times dr plus p times r. Right? And from these two equations, you easily derive a wave equation. So you differentiate again this equation and use this, and you get a wave equation. And the wave equation will be such that you see here appearing only the terms b derivatives of b, b dot derivatives of b dot, p derivative of p, and so on and so forth, for which you then prove transport equations. So this is quite a lengthy calculation. You show that derivatives with respect to L of B are multiples of B, B dot, P, and W. So M here means multiple. The same thing here I forgot to say. So this will mean you have something which is a multiple of all that stuff. So multiple of B, B dot, P, and W, and so on and so forth. Okay? So you get a closed system of equations, which is a wave equation of the form wave equations coupled with transport equations. Okay? And of course, it's for the wave equations that you need pseudo-convexity condition. Right? So the wave equation, obviously, you know, that to have unique continuation, you need pseudo-convexity. For the transport equation, well, the transport equations are just ODEs, so there's no problem. Okay? So that's basically the idea. But it's based on a rather lengthy calculation, but I think also sort of a very interesting calculation, because I think it's useful for many other things. In any case, you use then a continuation argument to conclude. So continuation argument, of course, you also have to do some work. Obviously, we did that in many previous papers that we had. We use, obviously, some geometric version of Kalman estimates. So using a geometric version of Kalman estimates, which is adapted to these sort of things, you prove the unique continuation. Okay, so that's another sort of big part, a big chunk that needs to be done. Let me go to theorem number two. So how do we prove theorem number two? So this is, again, if you try to do it directly, you will almost certainly fail because there are too many conditions that need to be satisfied. It might not be too difficult to construct a solution without stationarity. So if you want to construct an extension which is not stationary, it might be a little bit easier. Okay? I mean, it is a lot easier, actually. But of course, people will say, oh, well, but that's not stationary. Right? So we really wanted to make it stationary. And that's, of course, much harder. But the way we do it, right? So this is, again, the statement of the theorem, that you modify the metric G smoothly.
Such before, you can construct locally across these points, you can construct non-axially symmetric, is that right?
Yeah, that's exactly the statement, that we construct a solution, right? We construct a solution, which is an extension of the Einstein equation, of the Kerr solution. Is a solution of the Einstein equation, of course, it's very important. And it's also stationary. In other words, this Killing vector field of the Kerr spacetime extends as a Killing vector field across the boundary, right? And nevertheless, there is no axial symmetry, right? So that's what I think is interesting. So the proof is, again, it's based on solving a characteristic Cauchy problem, interestingly enough. Okay, so the moral is that unlike the analytic situation, one cannot hope to construct an additional symmetry. Anyway, so this is what we said. Okay, so here is how this is done. So you use the fact that you want to construct a stationary extension to reduce. So you look at solution of the Einstein equations which have a symmetry. So this there is a certain reduction that can be done. It's actually quite well known. If you have a Killing vector field, you can reduce the Einstein equations to a coupled, to a 2 plus 1 dimensional equations, where you see, so this is a 2 plus 1 dimensional metric now. So you remove one degree of freedom, you get a 2 plus 1 dimensional metric. This is a Ricci curvature. And on the right hand side, you have a derivative of a function x and a function y, which together, X and Y actually give you a wave map. As you see, this is a wave map. This is actually the wave map with values in the hyperbolic space, okay? The standard hyperbolic space. So you get a wave map coupled with this Ricci curvature. So it's again a highly nonlinear equation, but you remove the stationarity. So now if I construct a solution in this case, this will be stationary, okay? Automatically. And then the idea is to solve a characteristic Cauchy problem for this. Right. So you construct you solve a characteristic Cauchy problem where, again, I have a null hypersurface. Well, actually, we do it here, really. So you have a null hypersurface on one side. Right, sorry, it should be something like this. So you have a null hypersurface on one side and another null hypersurface which is transversal. You use data here and here to construct solutions of this equation. So again, it's a complicated characteristic problem for this funny type system, but this can be done, and you get the solution this way.
Well, how do you know it's not
x-symmetric? Well, since you see in the characteristic Cauchy problem, right? So you reduce everything to a characteristic Cauchy problem. So on one side, you have the Kerr solution, so the Kerr initial data, right? So there's nothing you can do that. But here on the other side, I have a lot of freedom to pick up the data. So I pick up it in such a way that I check that it's not axially symmetric. I mean, all I have to check, in fact, that it's not axially symmetric here. And then, okay.
But then do you characterize all possible extensions, local extensions, by
distinctions? But this is not a characterization, really. Oh, all possible solutions which are stationary and not axially symmetric. Probably. I mean, I would say. I mean, there is a lot of certainly. You know, it's a very constructive way of producing the counterexample. So there should be lots of those. Right? Okay. So I guess I'm out of time. I was hoping to tell you something more about the global results, which I think are very interesting. But maybe it's time to.